الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم أما بعد. All praise belong to Allah. We praise Him, we seek His assistance, and we seek His forgiveness. Seek refuge with Allah from the evils of our souls and from our wicked actions. Whomsoever Allah chooses to guide, then no one can misguide. And whomsoever He chooses to misguide, then there is no one who can guide them. I bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped in truth except Allah, alone without any partners, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His servant and final messenger. Indeed, the best speech is the speech of Allah, and the best guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The most evil of affairs are newly invented matters in the religion, and every newly invented matter in the religion is a misguidance, and every misguidance is in the hellfire. Inshallah ta'ala, today will be the first lesson in our readings from the book, A Comprehensive Guide for the New Muslim. Important lessons to help the new Muslim correctly practice Islam. And the origin of the compilation of this book was that I saw a need for the brothers who were incarcerated to have basic lessons and learning the basic teachings and tenets of Islam. For this reason, I began to compile writings and the basic matters of the religion. Alhamdulillah, until to the point that it became in book form. Alhamdulillah, one of our brothers, he advised to put it out in book form. And alhamdulillah, it was printed with Allah alhamd. Through Hikmah Publications. And it was checked by our dear Ustad Abu Abdullah Hassan Somali. So this is the book that we have in front of us. And inshallah ta'ala, we would like to start with the foreword from the words of the noble scholar Sheikh Salih al-Fawzan, hafidhahullah ta'ala, which is a very beneficial foreword to this book. Very concise, but very beneficial and comprehensive. In the foreword to this book, the words of Sheikh Salih Fawzan have been translated by our brother Mu'adh Qurashi from Sunnah Publications. So Sheikh Salih Fawzan, he mentions the praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending salutations upon our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, فَقَدْ خَلَقَ اللَّهُ الْخَلْقَ لِعِبَادَتِهِ قَالَ تَعَالَ وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. He said, indeed Allah has created the creation for His worship. Indeed Allah has created the creation for His worship. As Allah mentions in His book, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. And I did not create the jinn and mankind except to worship me. And this verse here, it shows us the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the jinn and mankind. This is the reason why Allah created the jinn, which is another creation that Allah created from fire, and mankind, which is us, human beings. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us to worship Him alone. And this is the evidence for that. Surah Al-Dhariyat, the 51st surah, ayat 56, the 56th verse. So if you were to be asked, why did Allah create you? Then this is your answer. This is your answer, and this is the proof for it. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I did not create the jinn and mankind except to worship me. Surah Al-Dhariyat, the 51st surah in the Qur'an, the 51st surah in the Qur'an, verse number 56. Sheikh Fawzani said, وَلَا يُعْبَدُ اللَّهَ إِلَّا بِمَا شَرَعَ وَقَدْ أَرْسَلَ رُسُلَهُ لِتُبَيْنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا شَرَعَهُ لِعِبَادِهِ لِأَنَّ عِبَادَةُ اللَّهِ بِغَيْرِ مَا شَرَعَهُ بَاطِلًا. He said, Allah is not to be worshipped except by that which He has legislated. Allah is not to be worshipped except by that which He has legislated. And He sent His messengers to clarify to the people all that he has legislated. Because worshipping Allah with other than what he has legislated is null and void. It's not accepted. Worshipping Allah with other than what he has legislated is null and void. وَخَتَمَ الرُّسَلَ بِرَسُولِهِ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ وَأَوْجَبَ عَلَى جَمِيعِ النَّاسِ اتِّبَاعَهُ قَالَ تَعَالَى قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ جَمِيعًا. And he ended the messengers with his messenger, the final messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, showing us that there were messengers before Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And his call, the call of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was the call of the messengers that came before him. Rather, the origin of all the calls of the messengers were the same, which was the call to worship Allah alone without any partners. And this is what every messenger came to with their people, or came to their people with. This is what every messenger came to their people with. As Allah mentions in many different ayah in the Quran, that the prophets, they said to their people, يَا قَوْمِ اعْبُدُ اللَّهِ مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَهٍ غَيْرِي. O my people, worship Allah. You have no deity in truth besides Him. And Allah mentions, وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا أَنِ اعْبُدُ اللَّهِ وَجَتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ. And indeed, we have sent to every nation a messenger, proclaiming what? Worship Allah and stay away from the false deities, the false gods worshipped besides Allah. So before Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there were prophets. Isa ibn Maryam, Jesus the son of Mary. Prophet Musa, Moses. Ibrahim, Abraham. Nuh, Prophet Noah. And other than them. Alayhi salatu wa salam. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon all of them. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the final messenger. And he ended the messengers with his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he made it obligatory upon all of mankind to follow him. And when we say Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he ended the messenger with Muhammad, who was intended is Muhammad, the son of Abdullah, and the grandson of Abdul Muttalib, the great grandson of Hashim. He was from the tribe of Quraysh. The Quraysh were from the Arabs. And the Arabs were from the progeny, the offspring of Ismail, the son of Ibrahim, alayhi salatu wassalam. So when we say Muhammad, this is who we mean. Not Elijah Muhammad, one who came and claimed prophethood, and claimed to be upon Islam, and claimed to be a prophet of Allah. He was a false prophet, and he has nothing to do with Islam. Islam is free from him, and he's free from Islam. Allah the Exalted, He said, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ جَمِيعًا. The evidence that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and He made him the final prophet, and He made it obligatory upon all of mankind to follow Him, is the saying of Allah, say, O Muhammad, O mankind, indeed I am the messenger of Allah to you all. O mankind, indeed I am the messenger of Allah to you all. So this includes the Arabs and the non-Arabs. Everybody on the face of the earth after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent, then he has been sent as a messenger to all of them. And Allah made it obligatory upon all of mankind to follow him. Sheikh Salih al-Fawzan, he goes on to say, فَمَنْ لَمْ يُؤْمِنْ بِمُحَمَّدٍ فَهُوَ كَافِرٍ وَدِينُ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ هُوَ الْإِسْلَامِ وَلَا يَقْبَلُ اللَّهُ دِينًا سِوَاهُ. So whoever does not believe in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is a disbeliever. And the religion of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Islam. And Allah will never accept any other religion besides it. Allah will never accept any other religion besides it. Allah mentions, وَمَنْ يَبْتَغِ غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا. ومن يبتغي غير الإسلام دينا فلن يقبل منه وهو في الآخرة من الخاسرين. And whoever seeks a religion other than Islam, they will never be accepted of him. And in the hereafter, he will be one of the losers. So this is a clear proof that Allah does not accept any other religion besides Islam. And whoever seeks a religion other than Islam, then it will never be accepted from him. And in the hereafter, he will be one of the losers. والإسلام الذي جاء به محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم له خمسة أركان: شهادة أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله وإقام الصلاة وإيتاء الزكاة وصوم رمضان وحج البيت الله الحرام ما الاستطاعة. The Islam that Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم came with has five pillars. And these are known as the pillars of Islam. And they'll come in more detail as we further our readings within the book. The first, which is the most important pillar of all the five pillars, the testimony that there is none worthy of worship, that there is none worthy of worship in truth besides Allah, and that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. This is the first pillar of Islam. Number two, the establishment of the prayer. What is meant is the obligatory prayers, the five obligatory prayers throughout the day and night. Number three, ita'u zakat, payment of the zakat, which is the charity upon the wealth given to the poor. Number four, fasting in the month of Ramadan, that blessed month, which is just a few days away, بإذن الله تعالى, that which we ask Allah to cause us to reach with safety and security. And number five, the Hajj, the pilgrimage. The pilgrimage to Mecca, to the sacred house of Allah, in accordance with one's ability. Pilgrimage to Mecca, to the sacred house of Allah, in accordance with one's ability. The sacred house of Allah, because Allah made that house, a noble place of worship. Rather, the first place of worship, place for the people. They're in Mecca. And for this reason, he mentioned the sacred house of Allah. It's called the sacred house of Allah, Bayt al-Haram in Mecca. The Sheikh Salih Fawzani says, مَا يَفْعَلُهُ مَنْ أَرَادَ الدُّخُولِ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ. What the individual who wishes to enter into Islam must do. So this is important. If you're a person who wants to enter into Islam, or if you know someone who wants to enter into Islam, what must they do? يَتَلَفَّظُ بِشَهَادَتَيْنِ ثُمَّ يَأْتِي بِأَرْكَانِ الْإِسْلَامِ عَلَى النَّحْوِ التَّالِي. He first, or she first, must utter the two testimonies of faith, that which we commonly know as the Shahada. That which we commonly know as the Shahada. They say, person will take the Shahada, meaning they utter the two testimonies of faith. And when a person utters these two testimonies of faith, then they must do that, they must utter that, upon knowledge and upon certainty, knowing the meaning of these two testimonies, saying them truthfully, believing in them, as Allah mentions in the Quran, إلا من شهد بالحق وهم يعلمون, except those who bear witness to the truth and they know. So it's not meant that a person says these two testimonies upon the tongue, but they don't believe them in the heart, nor do they know their meanings. But rather, they must say it upon knowledge. They must say these two testimonies and pronounce these two testimonies upon knowledge, knowing their meanings, and then they must act in accordance to them. So Sheikh Fawzan, he says, he must say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasul Allah. He must say, I bear witness, the translation of that which we just said, I bear witness that there is none worthy of worship besides Allah. And I bear witness that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. So one utters this, and they must utter it out loud. And in this, there's an affirmation and there's a negation, as it's going to come later on in the book, inshallah ta'ala. So when a person says, La ilaha, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, La ilaha, there's no deity. And this is a negation, Nafiyan jami' ma yu'badu min dunillah. And this is a negation of everything that is worshipped besides Allah. You're negating the right of worship for everything that is worshipped besides Allah, the true creator, the one true creator. And then when a person says the second part of that, illallah, except Allah, muthbitan al-ibadati lillahi wahda. In the second half, a person is affirming worship and the right for all worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the meaning of the shahada. La ma'abuda bihaqqin illallah. That there's no deity worthy of worship and truth except Allah. And that anything else, worship besides Allah, is only worshipped in falsehood. So this is what a person must understand when they pronounce the shahada. That there is no deity worthy of worship and truth except Allah, the sole creator, the sole provider, the sole sustainer, the giver of life, the one who decrees death, the one who controls the affairs of the heavens and the earth. He has no partners. He has no offspring. لم يلد ولم يولد. He wasn't born. He has no offspring. ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. There's nothing similar to him. When a person says, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله, again, this means, and what they're in reality, what they're saying, لا معبود بحق إلا الله, that there is no deity worthy of worship and truth except Allah. وبغير الله أن عبد, if anything else is worshipped besides Allah, then they are only worshipped in falsehood. Whether that be a prophet, or whether that be an angel, whether that be a man, or whether that be a stone, or whether that be a tree, all of those matters are only worshipped in falsehood, having no right. So this is what one must understand. And I bear witness that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So a person must utter this out loud. Then Sheikh Salih Fawzani goes on to say, number two, yusalli salawat al-khams. Then one must pray the five prayers. And these are the obligatory prayers throughout the day and the night. Al-fajr, the morning prayer. Al-dhuhr, the noon prayer. Al-asr, the afternoon prayer. Al-maghrib, the evening prayer. And Al-Isha, the night prayer. So one does this throughout the day and night, throughout the whole of their lives. Throughout the whole of their lives. Then Sheikh Fawzani goes on to say, ولا يصلي إلا بعد أن يتوضأ وذلك بغسل جميع الوجه وغسل اليدين مع المرفقين ومس الرأس وغسل الرجلين إلى الكعبين بالماء الطهور. And one must not pray any prayer except after he performs ablution, that which is known as wudu. And we have a chapter, inshallah ta'ala, which we dedicated for purification for the prayer. How does one purify themselves for the prayer? That will come in detail, inshallah ta'ala. So he says that occurs by washing the entirety of the face and washing the hands and arms up to and including the elbows and wiping the head and washing the feet up to and including the ankles with water, which is pure. And again, the detailed wudu, inshallah ta'ala, will come later on, bi-idhnillah, if Allah wills. He says, number three, إِذَا تَوَفَّرَ عِنْدُهُ مَالٌ يَزِيدُ عَنْ حَاجَتِهِ أَخْرَجَ مِنْهُ رُبْعَ الْأُشْرِ زَكَاةٍ لِلْفُقَرَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ كُلُّ سَنَةٍ وَإِنْ كَانَ مَالُهُ لَا يَزِيدُ حَاجَتَهُ فَلَا زَكَاةَ عَلَيْهِ. If a person possesses an abundance of wealth exceeding that for which he has need, then he must take out 2.5% of that wealth for zakat, for charity, alms for the needy and the destitute. And this is every year. A very small portion of a person's wealth given to the needy. And this is a purification of the wealth. And inshallah, we'll speak about that later on, inshallah ta'ala. And if his wealth does not exceed his need, then there is no zakat upon him. Number four, he says, يَصُومُ شَهْرَ رَمَضَانَ وَهُوَ شَهْرَ التَّاسِعِ مِنَ السَّنَةِ الْهِجْرِيَّةِ. Likewise, he must fast the month of Ramadan, the ninth month of the Hijri year. Again, that month, بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى, that's upon us just in a few days. He must fast the month of Ramadan, or she must fast the month of Ramadan, the ninth month of the Hijri year. He must abandon eating, drinking, sexual intercourse with his wife from dawn in the time of Fajr to sunset. And a person is permitted to eat, drink, and have sexual intercourse with his wife at night, meaning after the sun sets. إذا كان عنده المقدرة المالية والمقدرة البدنية فإنه يحج إلى بيت الله مرة واحدة في العمر وإن كانت المقدرة المالية ليس عنده نعم وليس عنده المقدرة البدنية لكبر أو مرضه المزمن فإنه يوكل من يحج عنه مرة واحدة. Likewise, if a person has the financial and physical capability, then he or she must perform the Hajj, the pilgrimage to the house of Allah, to Mecca, at least once in a lifetime. And if one has the financial capability, but he does not have the physical capability due to old age or due to a chronic illness, then he must entrust someone to perform the Hajj on his behalf. Number six, ما بقي من الطاعات فهو مكمل لهذه الأركان. Then he must perform whatever remains from acts of obedience, since that is a completion of these pillars. ما يلزم المسلم تركه. What is incumbent upon the new Muslim to abandon? Now, what is incumbent upon the new Muslim to abandon? Sheikh Fawzani says, يترك الشرك بجميع أنواعه بجميع أنواعه وهو عبادة غير الله ومنه الدعاء الأموات والذبح لهم والنذر لهم. First, one must abandon shirk. This is the greatest sin in Islam. He must abandon shirk, which means associating others with Allah and worship. Associating others with Allah and worship. Or giving Allah partners in worship. So one must abandon shirk in all of its types and forms. And again, that which is meant by shirk is to worship other than Allah. And from the types of shirk is that which occurs in supplication. That a person supplicates to the dead, or a person makes a sacrifice for the dead, for example, or takes oaths, or makes oaths for the dead, or takes oaths by the dead. All this is from shirk, because these acts of worship are only for Allah, and it's not permissible to direct any act of worship to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when a person makes dua, they make dua, they supplicate to Allah alone, the one who can hear your dua, the one who can answer you. Now, when a person sacrifices and slaughters, one sacrifices for Allah alone. When one takes an oath or a vow, one takes an oath and a vow for Allah alone, and so on and so forth. يترك البدع وهي العبادات التي لم يشرعها رسول الله محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم لقوله صلى الله عليه وسلم من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد أي لا تقبل. He must abandon innovations. And innovations are those acts of worship that have not been legislated by the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is due to the statement of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he said, whoever does an act that is not in accordance with this affair of ours, then it is rejected. Meaning, this means it is not accepted. Whoever does an act, meaning whoever does an act of worship, intending to draw close to Allah, intending that this act of worship is from the religion, but it's not in accordance with the religion. Prophet Muhammad SAW never came with it. He never legislated. He never legislated that act. فَهُوَ رَدْ Then it is rejected. Then it is rejected. Meaning it's not accepted. He says number three, يَتْرُكُ الرِّبَى وَالْقِمَارُ وَالْرِشْوَى وَالْكَذِبْ فِي الْمُعَامَلَاتِ وَالْبَيْعِ الْمَوَادِ الْمُحَرَّمَةِ وَالسِّلْعِ الْمُحَرَّمَةِ The Muslim likewise must abandon riba, usury. Riba, interest. Interest. Taking interest or giving interest. Or witnessing interest on loans and the likes. The Muslim must abandon this. Likewise, gambling. The Muslim doesn't gamble. Likewise, gambling. Whether this is at casinos or horse racetracks, or other than that, online, the Muslim must leave off gambling. And that is squandering of wealth. And that is oppression. And other than that, from the different harms in gambling. Rather, it's from the handiwork of the devil, as Allah described it. Likewise, bribes. One must abandon bribery. Likewise, lying in dealings and in transactions. And likewise, one must abandon buying and selling unlawful commodities. Anything which is unlawful from unlawful commodities, a person doesn't buy or sell them. Such as, for example, cigarettes, alcohol, and other than that. A person abandons those matters and does not buy nor sell them. Number four, يترك الزنا وهو جماع غير زوجته الشرعية ويترك اللواط وهو فعل المثليين. Likewise, a person must abandon zina, adultery or fornication. It is to have sexual intercourse with someone other than his lawfully wedded wife. So in Islam, the man must get married. He must get married and have intercourse in a lawfully recognized marriage. There's no boyfriends and girlfriends and the likes of that in Islam. Likewise with the woman. She gets married. She finds a suitable husband and gets married. And she doesn't fornicate. Likewise, Sheikh Fawzan says, the man, he must abandon homosexuality. And likewise for the woman, she abandons lesbianism and the likes, as none of this is permissible in Islam. Number 5, يترك شرب الخمر وأكل الخنزير وما ذبح لغير الله وأكل الميتات. He must abandon marriage to the disbelieving women who are not from the people of the book. Who are not from the people of the book, and the people of the book are the Jews and the Christians. So Allah has allowed the Muslim man in specific to marry the woman from the people of the book, meaning the women who are from the Jews or the Christians. But if she's not from the people of the book, it's not permissible for the Muslim man to marry. For example, if she was a Buddhist, if she was, for example, a Hindu, or for example, she was a Rastafarian, or for example, she was an atheist, and the likes of those matters, then it's not permissible. And no doubt that the Muslim, alhamdulillah, there's many Muslim women available for the Muslim man to marry. There are plenty. Wallah alhamd. Sheikh Fawzani says, يترك, and this is number 6, يترك الزواج من الكافرات غير الكتابيات. And Afwan, we just mentioned that. Number 7, يفارق زوجته الكافرة غير الكتابية إذا أسلمت إلا إل نعم إلا إذا أسلمت الكافرة معه أو في أثناء عدتها نعم. He must separate from his disbelieving wife who is not from the people of the book. So if he was already married and his wife was a disbeliever and she wasn't from the people of the book, he must separate from. So again, if she was an atheist or a Rastafarian or a Hindu or the likes, and they were married, then he must separate from her. If she was from the people of the book, then they're still married. He said, except if this disbelieving woman accepts Islam along with him, or doing her iddah, doing her waiting period. Yani the iddah period, which is the waiting period that the woman waits after she is divorced. إذا كان لا يضره الختان فإنه يختتن عند طبيب مسلم. Likewise for the new Muslim, and this is for the man, if circumcision will not harm him, then he must be circumcised by a Muslim surgeon. And lastly, number 9, إذا كان لا يستطيع الانتقال من بلد الكفار إلى بلد الإسلام فإنه ينتقل. إذا كان لا يستطيع الانتقال من بلد الكفار إلى بلد الإسلام فإنه ينتقل. This is an error here in the يعني in the printout. It should be إذا كان يستطيع. It says إذا كان لا يستطيع. So that's an error. If he is able to move, it should be. If he is able to move from the land of the disbelievers to the lands of Islam, then he must do so. Then he must do so. وَإِلَّا فَإِنُّهُ يَبْقَى فِي بَلَدِهِ مَعْ تَمَسُّكِهِ بِدِينِهِ. But if he is unable, a person is unable to move from the lands of disbelief to the lands of Islam and into the Muslim, to a Muslim country, if one is unable to do this, then he or she must remain in the country that they are in, and they must hold fast to their religion. They must hold fast to their religion. Written by Sheikh Salih Fawzan, the member of the Committee of Major Scholars in Saudi Arabia. And with this, we'll end this first lesson for the new Muslims. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa barak ala nabina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu. ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد. All praises for Allah, we praise Him, we seek His aid and we seek His forgiveness. We seek refuge with Allah from the evils of our souls and from our wicked actions. Whomsoever Allah chooses to guide, then no one can misguide. Whomsoever He chooses to misguide, then there is no one who can guide. Bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped in truth except Allah. He is alone without any partners. And that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is His servant and final messenger. And with this, we'll continue, inshallah ta'ala, reading from a comprehensive guide for the new Muslim. Important lessons to help the new Muslim correctly practice Islam. And last week, we opened up with the very beneficial introduction by Sheikh Salih Fawzan, may Allah preserve him, regarding what is incumbent upon the new Muslim to implement and to abandon. And we read that last week. So we'll continue with the following chapter. Chapter 1, which is titled, Actions Are Judged by Intentions. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned in a very famous hadith, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَّا نَوَى فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ لِدُنْيَا يُصِيبُهَا أَوْ امْرَأَةٍ يَنْكِحُهَا فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى مَا هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِ. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, actions are judged by intentions. And a person will only get what they intended. So whoever's migration is for Allah and His Messenger, meaning he intends to be with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and with the believers, and he migrates for that reason. It's done for the sake of Allah. Whoever's migration is for Allah and His Messenger, then his migration is for Allah and His Messenger. He will be recompensed upon that. And that will be his reward. And whoever's migration is to gain something of the worldly life, or to marry a woman, then his migration is for what he migrated for. So this hadith, O Muslim, many of the scholars of Islam, they will begin their books with it. And although there are many benefits that are derived from this hadith, and the scholars, they derive numerous benefits from this one hadith, one of the most important benefits is that a person corrects their intention in every action that they do. That a person corrects their intention in every act that they do in order to draw close to Allah. Any act of worship that they do, any act that they do seeking the pleasure of Allah, or where Allah's pleasure is sought, that the Muslim corrects their intention. That the Muslim corrects their intention. One of the scholars of Islam, Ibn Rajab, who was an 8th century scholar of Islam, he stated about this hadith, the hadith, actions are by intentions. He said, وَاتَّبَقَ الْعُلَمَاءَ عَلَى صُحَّتِهِ وَتَلَقِّيهِ بِالْقَبُولِ وَبِهِ صَدَّرَ الْبُخَارِيُ كِتَابُهُ الصَّحِيحِ وأقامه مقام الخطبة له إشارة منه إلى أن كل عمل لا يراد به وجه الله فهو باطل لا ثمرة له في الدنيا ولا في الآخرة. He said, the scholars agree regarding its authenticity. In the hadith is authentic, meaning it was reported from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam without a doubt. It's authentic. They've received with full acceptance. And Imam Bukhari, he began his book Sahih with this hadith and he made it stand in the place of his introduction. And this is tremendous right here. And Imam Bukhari, for those who are not familiar with Imam Bukhari, that he was a 3rd century scholar of Islam who compiled a collection of authentic narrations traced back to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and his book, which is commonly referred to as Sahih Bukhari, is considered the soundest book in regards to authenticity after the Quran. It's considered the most soundest book as it relates to authenticity after the Quran. So Imam Bukhari, he didn't start his book, his compilation of authentic ahadith, he didn't bring an introduction to his book, but rather what he started with was what? This hadith, actions are by intentions. And a person will only get what they intended. So whoever's migration is for Allah and His Messenger, then his migration is for Allah and His Messenger. And whosoever's migration is to gain something of the worldly life, or to marry a woman, then his migration is for what he migrated for. So Ibn Rajab, he continues and he says, he did this, meaning he made it stand in the place of his introduction, as a subtle indication from him that every action in which a person does not seek the face of Allah, that it is void and it has no benefit in this life or in the next. This is very important. Every action that a person does, meaning every action of worship, every action that is done in order to draw close to Allah, but a person, he doesn't do that action, seeking the face of Allah, meaning hoping to see Allah in the hereafter, and hoping for His paradise in the hereafter, then that action is void and has no benefit in this life or in the next. So therefore, every act of worship you do, whether that be learning your religion, because learning your religion is ibadah, is worship, if your intention is correct. So whether that be learning your religion, so you can worship Allah upon clarity, or whether that be prayer, or whether that be fasting, or other than that, then make your intention solely and sincerely for Allah's sake alone, seeking to obtain the great reward He prepared for the believers and the hereafter. Naam, so this is important. This is very important that a person doesn't do their actions seeking anything from the worldly life. A person doesn't do it seeking anything from the worldly life. A person doesn't do it seeking to please anyone. A woman doesn't do it seeking to please a man. A man doesn't do it seeking to please a woman. But rather, every action that you do, an act of worship, then make your intention solely and sincerely to please Allah. And make it for His sake alone, wanting to obtain the reward He's prepared for the believers in the hereafter. Move on to the next chapter, chapter 2, which is the obligation of seeking knowledge. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Prophet Muhammad, he said, طلب العلم فريضة على كل مسلم. Seeking knowledge is obligatory upon every Muslim. What type of knowledge is this that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam referred to? Is it knowledge of technology or mathematics, or the different sciences? La. That which is intended behind seeking knowledge, which is obligatory upon every Muslim. One of the Imams of Islam, Sufyan al-Thawri, from the 2nd century scholars and the pious predecessors, he clarified this and said, it is that knowledge which the servant has no excuse to be ignorant of. What it refers to is that knowledge which the servant and we're all servants of Allah and slaves of Allah, has no excuse to be ignorant of. Meaning, you never can be excused to be you will never have an excuse to be ignorant of these matters. That's what's intended. And Sheikh Ibn Baz, Sheikh Abdulaziz Ibn Baz, from the scholars of Islam, he clarified this. He said, may Allah have mercy upon him, Sheikh Ibn Baz, he said, أنت يا عبد الله مخلوق لهذه العبادة مأمور بأدائها على الوجه المطلوب الذي شرعه الله ولا سبيل لك إلى ذلك إلا بالله ثم بالتفقه في الدين. He said, you, O servant of Allah, were created for the worship of Allah. And in the foreword of the book, we heard the statement of Sheikh Salih al-Fawzan when he mentioned that Allah only created the creation to worship Him alone. And he mentioned the verse in the Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا. And I have not created jinn or mankind except to worship Me. So he says, you, O servant of Allah, were created for the worship of Allah and have been commanded to perform it in its proper manner, in which Allah legislated. There's no way to obtain this except by the aid of Allah, meaning by Allah aiding you and assisting you upon this, and then by seeking understanding of the religion. He says, فَعَلَى كُلِّ مُكَلَّفٍ أَنْ يَتَعَلَّمَ مَا لَا يَسْعُهُ جَهْلُهُ مِنَ الرِّجَالِ وَالنِّسَاءِ حَتَّى يَتَعَلَّمَ مَا أَوْجَبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَمَا حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَحَتَّى يُؤَدِّيَ مَا أَوْجَبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ وَحَتَّى يَمْتَنِعَ عَمَّا نَهَى اللَّهُ عَنْهُ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ هَذَا وَاجِبُ الْجَمِيعِ. He said, so it is incumbent upon everyone who's mukallif, who's Islamically accountable for their actions. And if you've a person who's reached the age of puberty and you're of sound intellect, then you're a person who's Islamically accountable for everything that you do. And everything that you do will be written down, either for you or either against you. So it's upon everyone Islamically accountable for their actions to learn those matters that are not permissible to be ignorant of. This is for men and women. It's not just for men. And it's not just for women. But it's for both. It's for men and women. He said this is so they may learn what is obligatory upon them and what Allah made impermissible for them, and so that they can perform what Allah made obligatory upon them, doing that upon correctness and insight. Doing that upon correctness and insight. And so that one can stay away from what Allah made prohibited them from, and you stay away from that likewise upon insight. Why? Because you know that Allah prohibited, and you know that His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited. And that which you do it because you know that Allah commanded with it. And you know that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded with it. So you do all of that upon insight, upon clarity. He said, this is what is obligatory upon everyone. And Sheikh Salih al-Fawzan, he mentions, مِنَ الْعِلْمِ مَا هُوَ وَاجِبٌ وُجُوبٌ عَيْنِيًا عَلَى كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ أَنْ يَعْرِفَهُ وَلَا يَعْبُرُ أَحَدٌ بِجَهْلِهِ وهو معرفة ما لا يستقيم دين العبد إلا به من أحكام عقيدته وأحكام صلاته وزكاته وصومه وحجه فهذا القسم من العلم هذا القدر من العلم واجب على كل مسلم أن يعرفه معرفة تامة ولا يعذر أحد بجهله لأنه لا يمكن أن يستقيم دين الإنسان إلا به. And Sheikh Salih al-Fawzan, he stated, among the types of knowledge is that which is an individual obligation upon every Muslim to know. And no one is excused of being ignorant of. So this is to have knowledge of the matters which the servant's religion cannot be correct except by learning them. Such as the matters of his or her aqidah, their belief system, the rulings of the Salat, the prayer, the obligatory prayers, his or her giving of Zakat, the obligatory charity, his or her fasting, and we're now in the month of Ramadan, a person must know how to fast upon clarity. A person must know how to fast. When does fasting begin? When does the fasting day start? What must you do before the fast? What must you say before that? Do you need the intention that you need, the obligatory intention you need before the fasting? And other than that, for example. And likewise, Hajj, the pilgrimage. And these are the pillars of Islam. He said, therefore, this area of knowledge, or this portion of knowledge, is obligatory upon every Muslim to know thoroughly. And no one is excused from having ignorance of it. This is because it is not possible that a person's religion be correct except with it. You must know the correct aqidah, the correct belief in Allah. You must know how to pray correctly. If you are a person whom Allah blessed with money, an excess of money, you must know how to give zakat upon your wealth. When Ramadan comes, you must know how to fast in the correct manner. If you have the financial and physical capabilities, then you must make the Hajj. Now, and you must do this upon clarity and upon certain knowledge. Now, and we'll read through one more chapter, inshallah. This is chapter 3, the importance of the correct aqidah. The importance of the correct belief system. So know, O Muslim, that the first matter you must give importance to is learning the correct aqidah, or the correct Islamic belief system. The correct Islamic belief system. So there are many creeds and beliefs. There are many creeds. There are many beliefs. But the only correct belief system is what Allah has clarified in the Quran and what His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam clarified in his Sunnah. So this is what is known as the Aqidah. This is what is known as the Aqidah. And the Aqidah is your foundation. It's your foundation. Before any other matter of the religion, before the prayer, before fasting, before the Hajj, the aqidah and knowing the aqidah and the correct aqidah, the correct belief system, knowledge of this is your foundation. Excuse me. And the distinguishing characteristic of the people who follow the Quran and Sunnah and who follow the companions of Prophet Muhammad, they give importance to learning the aqidah first before everything, and they become firmly grounded in it. This is a distinguishing characteristic of the Muslim who strives to adhere to the Quran and to the Sunnah and the way of the companions of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Sheikh Salih Fawzan, he addresses this issue of learning the correct aqidah. He says, فَأَنِّي أَنصَحُ لِلشَّبَابِ وَغَيْرِهِمْ مِنْ الْمُسْلِمِينَ أَنْ يَهْتَمُّوا بِالْعَقِيدَةِ أَوَّلًا وَقَبْلَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. I advise the youth. And we're all youth as it relates to this religion. And likewise, in comparison to the elderly scholars of Islam. I advise the youth and other than them, from the Muslims, to give great concern to the aqidah firstly, before everything. This is because the aqidah is the foundation which all actions are built upon as far as them being accepted or rejected. فَإِنْ كَانَتِ الْعَقِيدَةِ صَحِيحًا مُوَافَقَةً لِمَا جَاءَ بِهِ الرُّسُلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ خُصُوصًا خَاتِمَ النَّبِيِّينَ نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ فَإِنَّ سَائِرَ الْأَعْمَالِ تُقْبَلُ. If the aqidah is sound, the belief system, if it is sound and correct and in accordance to what the messengers came with, especially the seal of them, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then the rest of the actions will be accepted if they are done sincerely seeking the face of Allah, the Most High. Again, going back to what we spoke about regarding the intentions and having correct intentions. He says, إذا كانت هذه الأعمال خالصة لوجه الله تعالى وموافقة لما شرع الله ورسوله. If they are done sincerely seeking the face of Allah, the Most High, and in accordance to what Allah and His Messenger have legislated. وإذا كانت العقيدة فاسدة أو كانت ضالة مبنية على العوائد وتقليد الآباء والأجداد وكانت عقيدة شركية فإن الأعمال مردودة لا يقبل منها شيء ولو كان صاحبها مخلصا وقاصدا بها وجه الله. He said, however, if the aqidah, if the belief system is corrupted or is misguided due to it being based upon traditions, customs, or blind following of one's forefathers, due to it being based upon traditions, or blind following of one's forefathers, my mother was upon this, so I'm going to be what my mother was upon. Or my father was upon this, so I'm upon what my father was upon. Or my ancestors were upon this, so I want to be upon what my ancestors were upon. No, a person has to look. If that which your mother was upon, or your father, your ancestors, if that which they were upon, is that what Allah legislated, then nah, there's no problem with that. However, they're upon a belief system or aqidah other than what Allah legislated, then it's not permissible to follow them in that. It is not permissible to follow them in that. So he says, Sheikh Salih al-Fawzan, Naam, he says, or it is an aqidah that entails shirk, associating partners with Allah, then those actions will be rejected, and none of them will be accepted, even if one had done them with sincerity and seeking the face of Allah. And this is because Allah does not accept any actions except what is done sincerely seeking His noble face, and likewise done upon the sunnah of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So whoever desires salvation for their soul and they desire to have their deeds accepted and they desire to be a true Muslim, then one must give importance to the aqidah, to the belief system. فَعَلَيْهِ أَنْ يَعْتَنِي بِالْعَقِيدَةِ. He must give importance to the correct belief system. How is this? بِأَنْ يَعْرِفَ الْعَقِيدَةِ الصَّحِيحَةِ وَمَا يُضَادُهَا وَمَا يُنَاقِضُهَا. This is by knowing the sound and correct belief and also knowing what nullifies it and what contradicts it. This is important. That you must know the correct belief. You must know the correct belief that Allah has clarified in His book, the Qur'an. And likewise, that was the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ came with and what he taught to his companions and what he taught to this ummah, his nation. You must know that and learn it and believe it and implement it. And likewise, you must know that which contradicts it so that you may abstain, so you may stay away from it. You must know what contradicts it in order that you may stay away from it. That way, if you see anything or you hear anything that goes against the correct aqidah, you say, no, this goes against what Allah legislated. This goes against what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with. And you reject it. Because again, the correct Islamic belief system, this is what guarantees a person's actions being accepted. Because if a person even if they claim Islam, if they are upon a false or erroneous belief system, then their actions won't be accepted. Their actions won't be accepted, rather they'll be rejected. So Sheikh Fawzani goes on to say, حَتَّى يَبْنِ أَعْمَالُهُ عَلَيْهَا وَذَلِكَ لَا يَكُونُ إِلَّا بِتَعَلُّمِهَا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ وَأَهْلِ الْبَصِيرَةِ الَّذِينَ تَلَقَّوْهَا عَنْ سَلَفِ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ. He says, so this is by knowing the sound, the correct belief system, and also knowing what nullifies it and contradicts it. So one can base their actions upon it. And this can only occur by learning it from the people of knowledge. Learning it from the people of knowledge. Those people who are going to teach you Quran and Sunnah. And the people who have insight, who have learned it from the Salaf of this Ummah. And we'll discuss who the Salaf were, inshallah ta'ala, in an upcoming chapter. So Allah said to His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, He said, فَعَلَمْ, He commanded him, فَعَلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ. Know that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah, then seek forgiveness for your sins. Know that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah, then seek forgiveness for your sins. So look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look how Allah commanded Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with first knowing the aqeedah. Because la ilaha illallah, the statement which we discussed briefly last week, in reality this is the aqeedah. Allah said to His Prophet Muhammad, فَعَلَمْ, know first, أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ, that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah. This entails what? Negation and affirmation. Now, that you affirm worship for Allah alone, that He's the only one deserving of all worship, and that you negate the right of worship from everyone besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is in essence the aqeedah. This is in essence the belief system and the foundation of the belief system. So this is what Allah commanded Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam first, and then He said, وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ, then seek forgiveness for your sins. Imam Bukhari, that great imam that we spoke about earlier, that 3rd century scholar, he said, he placed the chapter heading in his book. He said, بَابٌ الْعِلْمُ قَبْلِ الْقَوْلِ وَالْعَمَلِ. He said, chapter, and he brought this verse, which is in Surah Muhammad, verse 19. He said, knowledge precedes speech and action. فَبَدَأَ بِالْعِلْمِ قَبْلِ الْقَوْلِ وَالْعَمَلِ. Why? Because Allah, in this verse, He began with what? Knowledge first, before speech and action. So before a person speaks, or before they do any actions, then it is a must that they have ilm, they have knowledge, and the head of all branches of knowledge, and the most important of them is knowledge of the aqeedah, knowledge of the belief system. So the Islamic belief to other fields of knowledge and actions is equivalent to the foundation of a building or the roots of a tree. So just as the building will not stand except upon a foundation, you can't build a building upon a flimsy premise or a flimsy foundation, or a foundation which is not sturdy, it will fall. So just as the building will not stand except on a strong foundation, a tree will not stand except upon strong roots, then similarly the actions of an individual and his knowledge will be of no benefit unless it is built upon the correct belief. So again, the aqeedah is at the status of the foundation of a building. As it relates to Islam, the aqeedah is at the status of the foundation of a building. A person must have a strong aqeedah, and upon that, they build their actions and they build their knowledge. Focusing on matters of belief has precedence over other affairs such as food and drink and clothing, because it is through the correct belief, the correct aqeedah, that the believer lives a truly happy life, and his soul becomes pure, and his actions are correct. His acts of obedience are accepted. And he is raised in degrees before Allah, the Mighty Majestic. However, if the belief of the aqeed is faulty, or is corrupt, or if it's absent, then this will have the opposite effect upon all of his affairs, all of his actions. So therefore, a corrupt belief is a source of ruin for the individual as it pertains to his actions and his mannerisms, and it debases and destroys him. Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah ta'ala, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, who was a renowned 8th century scholar of Islam, he said, additionally, those who oppose Ahl al-Hadith, the people of Hadith, meaning that those who cling to the narrations of Prophet Muhammad and they adhere to them and they adhere to those narrations in all affairs of the religion. He said, those who oppose them, they're expected to have corrupt actions, either due to an evil belief, hypocrisy, a sickness in the heart, or a weakness of faith. He said, the abandonment of the obligations, transgression of the legislated boundaries, disdain and disregard for the ordained rights, and hardness of the heart is found among them, which is visible to everyone. And many of their scholars, their shuyukh, are accused of serious offenses. So here again, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he's clarifying those who oppose the people of the sunnah, the people of hadith, and those who do not base their actions upon the correct aqeed and the correct belief system, then they're expected to have corrupt actions, and you'll see this clearly upon them. If the belief is sound and firm, and based upon the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of His Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then a person will be upright, because the basis of piety and uprightness is present within him. Because the basis of piety and uprightness is present within him. Just like Allah mentions in His Book, "Alam tara kayfa daraba Allahu mathalan." كلمة طيبة كشجرة طيبة أصلها ثابت وفرعها في السماء. Have you not seen how Allah sets forth a parable, an example? A goodly word as a goodly tree, whose root is firmly fixed and its branches reach to the sky. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse, He's made the fundamental matters of faith, meaning the aqeedah, and its foundations, which is belief, equivalent to the roots that the tree stands upon. Again, this is a verse showing the importance of the aqeedah. A goodly word, which is La ilaha illallah, is like a goodly tree, whose roots is firmly fixed in the ground, and its branches reach up to the sky. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the fundamental matters of faith and its foundations, which is belief, equivalent to the roots that the tree stands upon. Thus, if the root is firm, then this tree is closer to completeness in terms of its growth, development, and the deliciousness of its fruits, depending upon the correctness of this foundation. So again, this is important. If a person's aqeed is sound and is correct, and a person's Islam is built upon a firm and correct belief system, then they'll see the fruits and benefits of their Islam. They'll see the fruits and the benefits of their Islam. Because the aqeed is based upon giving Allah His rights. And Allah, the greatest right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He be worshipped alone. And that no partners be associated with Him in worship. Now, so if a person's foundation is firm and a person worships Allah as He commanded and stays away from shirk and stays away from bid'ah, innovations, and other than that from the prohibited matters, and that aqeedah is firm, then a person will see the growth of their Islam and they'll see the completeness of their Islam if Allah wills. Again, Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he also mentions, he says, as for Ahl Sunnah wal Hadith, it is not known that any of their scholars, nor their righteous common folk, ever renounced their doctrine and creed. They never renounced their aqidah, their belief. Rather, they were the most patient of the people upon that. Even if they were tested with all types of tests and trials, with all types of tribulations. And we can even give an example to what we're going through right now with the coronavirus crisis. Those who have correct belief and correct iman, alhamdulillah, they're patient during these trials. They're patient. And they know that whatever befalls them and whatever afflicts them, then it wasn't going to pass them. It was something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed upon them. And they're pleased. عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ. How amazing is the fear of the believer. Indeed, all of his fear is good. That is not, and that is for none other than the believer. إِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ السَّرَّاءُ شَكَرْ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ. If good befalls him, he's thankful and that's better for him. وَنْ أَصَابَتْهُ الضَّرَّاءُ صَبْرْ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ. And if some difficulties befell him or her, they're patient and that's better for them. So this shows again the importance of the aqidah. When trials and tribulations come, a person flees back and they return back and they resort back to their belief system. But you'll find those who don't have a correct belief system, you'll find they put their trust in the doctors and they put their trust in the scientists and they put their trust in these individuals who can't bring them any benefit nor ward off from them any harm. But you find them busying themselves with conspiracy theories and other than that, the Muslim remains patient and resorts back to their belief system. So again, this right here shows these words of Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala are appropriate for that which we're going through right now. You find them the most patient of the people upon their creed and upon their belief. Even if they're tested with all types of tests and trial with all types of tribulations. So compare this with the wavering of the people of theological rhetoric. Those who base their belief upon suspicions and upon philosophies and things like that. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala said, Ahlul Kalam, meaning those who base their religion upon theological rhetoric, suspicions and philosophies and things like that, they're the people who waver most from one doctrine to another. They're found to be certain about a matter in one place and then certain about its exact opposite in another place. Why? Because it's not based upon the Quran and Sunnah. It's based upon the statements and opinions invented by mankind. He says, and they declare the one who asserts this to be a disbeliever. They are found to be certain about a matter in one place and then certain about its exact opposite in another place, and they declare the one who asserts this to be a disbeliever, and this is a proof of their lack of certainty. So you find the people of philosophy and the people of speculation and those who base their belief systems upon that, you find them always wavering, not firm upon one thing, because it's not based upon the sound belief in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down. And inshallah ta'ala, with this we'll end. Next week we'll continue in chapter 4, Tawhid and its types. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa barak ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. Our praises for Allah, we praise Him. We seek His aid and we seek His forgiveness. We seek refuge with Allah from the evils of our souls and from our wicked actions. Whomsoever Allah chooses to guide, then no one can misguide. Whomsoever he chooses to misguide, and there is no one who can guide. And I bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped in truth except Allah. He is alone without any partners. And that Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is his servant and final messenger. So inshallah ta'ala, we'll continue reading from the comprehensive guide for the new Muslim. And last week we spoke about the importance of the aqidah, the importance of being upon the correct belief system. And inshallah ta'ala, we'll continue with the next chapter, which is chapter 4, which is an extension of what we talked about last week about the importance of the aqidah, the belief system. We'll speak about, inshallah ta'ala, today, Tawhid, and its types. So, dear Muslim, the first obligation upon you is to know Allah through His Tawhid. The first obligation upon you is to know Allah through His Tawhid. And this term Tawhid, as it relates to the aspect of the Arabic language, it means to make something one. To make something one. And Islamically, when we say Tawhid, as it relates to the religion of Islam, Islamically, Tawhid, it means Ifradullahi bil-ibadah. It means to single out Allah with all acts of worship. It means to single out Allah with all acts of worship. And Tawhid, the scholars, they mention, is of three types. In these three types, they're all found in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the scholars, when they looked at the Quran, and they looked and examined the different types of Tawhid mentioned in the Quran, they saw it to be, or they saw that it did not go outside of three types. And this is where we get this categorization of Tawhid from. So Tawhid is of three types of Tawhid. And inshallah ta'ala, I want the new Muslim to memorize each type of Tawhid, each category, not just the name, but likewise the meanings. What is meant by each type of Tawhid? And inshallah ta'ala, this lesson will go over each type bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, if Allah wills. So the first type of Tawhid is known as Tawhid al-Rububiyyah. Tawhid al-Rububiyyah, or the Tawhid of Allah's Lordship. The Tawhid of Allah's Lordship. And this means to have belief that Allah is the sole creator of everything, and that He controls and disposes of all affairs in the heavens and earth and in the universe and all that is in between them. Or one can say that it is to single Allah out and His actions. So again, Tawhid al-Rububiyyah, Tawhid of Allah's Lordship. This means to have belief that Allah is the sole creator of everything. Allah is the sole creator of everything created. And He's the controller of those things. He's the one who disposes of all the affairs in the heavens and the earth, and everything that is in between them. He's in control of all of that without any partners. Or one can say that Tawhid al-Rububiyyah is to single Allah out and His actions, meaning Allah's actions, from his actions is that what? That he's the sole creator. Al-Khaliq. He's the sole creator of all of mankind. And everything else. From the creation. He's the sole provider of all of mankind. No one provides for the creation along with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah is the only one who gives life and causes death. He has no partners in this. And other than that, from his actions. And Allah has no partners in any of that. This is Tawhid al-Rububiyyah. Singling Allah out with his actions. That he is alone in creating the creation. That he is alone in providing for the creation. He is alone in controlling the affairs of the heavens and the earth. He has no partners alone. He has no partners in any of that. This is Tawhid al-Rububiyyah. However, affirming this type of Tawhid, Tawhid al-Rububiyyah, this first type, is not sufficient for one to enter into the fold of Islam and to be a Muslim. Why is this? The disbelievers in the time of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they themselves acknowledge this type of Tawhid. They acknowledge this type of Tawhid and they believed it. However, their mere acknowledge of Tawhid al-Rububiyyah, of Allah's actions that we just mentioned, it did not enter them into the fold of Islam. Why is this? Because even with their acknowledge of those matters, that Allah is the sole creator, provider, giver of life and death, they still directed acts of worship to other than Allah, from their idols, or to the creation such as revered saints or angels or pious men or other than that. Their idols, they still directed acts of worship to other than the creator, to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And due to this, and even though their acknowledgement of Tawhid al-Rububiyyah, Allah and His Messenger still deemed them to be disbelievers. So this shows a great point, which is what just the mere acknowledge of Tawhid al-Rububiyyah does not enter a person into Islam. And to the affirm, the second type of Tawhid, along with this, and inshallah ta'ala, we'll get to that in a bit, bi-idhnillah ta'ala. So Allah commanded His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah commanded His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to say to these disbelievers, as it comes in the Quran, Surah Yunus, and other places in the Quran, such as Surah Mu'mineen, قُلْ مَنْ يَرْزُقُكُمْ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَمَّنْ يَمْلِكُ السَّمْعَ وَالْأَبْصَارِ وَمَنْ يُخْرِجُ الْحَيَّ مِنَ الْمَيِّتِ ويخرج الميت من الحي ومن يدبر الأمر فسيقولون الله فقل أفلا تتقون. Say to these individuals, O Muhammad, who provides for you from the heavens and the earth? Who is it that controls the hearing and the sight? And who brings the living out of the dead? And brings the dead out of the living? And who arranges every matter? Who controls all of the affairs? Then they will surely say Allah. They will surely say Allah. Meaning those disbelievers that you were sent to, if you were to say this to them, then they will respond, Allah. So respond to them. Say to them, أَفَلَا تَتَّقُونَ. Will you then not fear Him? So this verse shows you that the disbelievers, they already affirmed Allah's actions. They already affirmed Allah's rububiyyah. They knew that He had no partner in those matters, creating the creation, providing for the creation, controlling the matters of the heavens and the earth. But even with this, They turn acts of worship, such as seeking blessings, such as dua, supplication, such as prayer, such as vowing, such as slaughtering, they turn those actions to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they remained upon shirk because of that. They remained upon shirk because of that, and that did not enter them into Islam. So this is important. This is important. So a person cannot say that I believe in Allah, that He's the sole creator and sole provider, and that He's the controller of the heavens and the earth. This is Tawhid. This is Tawhid. But then you find them, for example, they go to a person in the grave and they supplicate to them, or make a vow or offering or slaughtering for that person inside the grave. And then they say that this is Islam, or I'm a Muslim. La. Because Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, this is the same Tawheed that the Kuffar, the disbelievers in the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they affirmed, but that did not enter them into Islam. Shaykh Abdul Rahman ibn Nasir al-Sa'di rahimahullah, he says about this ayat in Surah Yunus that we just quoted, this ayat here on page 22 in our book. Imam al-Sa'di, he said, meaning, قُلْ لِهَأُولَىٰ الَّذِينَ أَشْرَكُوا بِاللَّهِ مَا لَمْ يُنَزِّلْ بِهِ سُلْطَانًا. Meaning, say to these disbelievers, O Muhammad, say to these disbelievers who associate partners with Allah, that which He sent down, no authority. مُحْتَجًا عَلَيْهِمْ بِمَا أَقَرُّوا بِهِ مِنْ تَوْحِيدِ الرُّوبِيَّةِ. Using against them what they already acknowledge. Using against them what they already acknowledge from Allah's actions, His Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. In order to compel them to acknowledge what they deny. Meaning that He should be worshipped alone without any partners. So this is an argument that Allah used against the mushrikeen in the Quran. The disbelievers. And it's an argument against all the disbelievers until Yawm al-Qiyamah, who affirm Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, but deny Allah's right to be worshipped alone. This is an argument against all of them. If you affirm the former, then you must affirm the latter. If you affirm as al-Rububiyyah, then you must single them out with all worship. So he says, مُحْتَجٍ عَلَيْهِمْ بِمَا أَقَرُّوا بِهِ مِنْ تَوْحِيدِ الرُّبُوبِيَّةِ. Using against them what they already acknowledge from Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, from Allah's actions, His Rububiyyah, His Lordship, to compel them to acknowledge what they deny from His Uluhiyyah, from His sole right to be worshipped alone, which is the second type of Tawheed. We'll get to that in a bit. Say to them, مَنْ يَرُزُقُكُمْ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Who provides for you from the heavens and the earth? Who provides for you from the heavens and the earth? Imam al-Sa'di says, بِإِنْزَالِ الْأَرْزَاقِ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَإِخْرَاجِ أَنْوَاعِهَا مِنَ الْأَرْضِ وَتَيْسِيرِ أَسْبَابِهَا فِيهَا. Sending down rain and causing various types of provisions to grow from the earth. Naam. When Allah sends down the rain is one, the earth is one, but look at the different types of provisions that grow from the earth. Wheats, grains, corns, vegetables, fruits. Other than that. Nah. So this is something they affirm. This is something every disbeliever will affirm. There's no way to deny it. There's no way to deny it. أَمَّنْ يَمْلِكُ السَّمْعَ وَالْأَبْصَارِ. Who is he that controls the hearing and sight? Meaning what? A, من هو الذي خلقهما وهو مالكهما. Who created the hearing and the sight within you? The two eyes that you have. The blessing of hearing that you have. Who created that? No one from mankind created that. Only Allah. And Allah specifically mentioned, مخصهما بالذكر من باب التنبيه المفضول بالفاضل ولكمال شرفهما ونفعهما. Allah mentioned the hearing and the sight due to the extreme blessings of these two senses. So what about anything less than them? If Allah created within you the hearing and the sight, something that is, if it's taken from you, you can't get it back, then all the more He created that which is less than that from limbs and other than that. وَمَنْ يُخْرِجُ الْحَيَّ مِنَ الْمَيِّتِ. And who brings the living out of the dead? And who brings the living out of the dead? Meaning what? كَإِخْرَاجْ أَنْوَعَ الْأَشْجَارُ وَالنَّبَاتِ مِنْ الْحُبُوبِ وَالنَّوَاءِ. Meaning, look how Allah, for example, causes various plants and trees to emerge just from seeds, this planet. Just from seeds that are planted. They come to life, becoming trees and becoming plants by which the people they benefit from. وإخراج المؤمن من الكافر. Look how Allah guides the disbeliever to belief. Because the disbelief in reality, is dead. His heart is dead because of his disbelief. So Allah guides the disbelievers whom He chooses to belief, having life. وَالطَّائِرُ مِنْ الْبَيْضَةِ. Look how Allah, for example, brings the bird just from an egg. And other than that, وَيُخْرِجُ الْمَيِّتِ مِنَ الْحَيِّ. And brings the dead out of the living. Yani the opposite of that which was just mentioned. وَمَنْ يُدَبِّرُ الْأَمْرِ. وَمَنْ يُدَبِّرُ الْأَمْرِ. And who arranges every matter? Who arranges all the affairs? فِي الْعَالَمِ الْعُلَوِي وَالصُّفَلِ. In the entire universe. In the heavens and the earth. Who arranges and controls all of this? فَإِنَّكِ إِذَا سَأَلْتُمْ عَنْ ذَلِكِ. If you were to ask them, O Muhammad, about all of these affairs that were just mentioned, فَسَيَقُولُونَ اللَّهَ. They would say Allah. They would acknowledge and they would say Allah. لَأَنُّمْ يَعْتَرِفُونَ بِجَمِيعِ ذَلِكَ. They affirm all of this. وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ فِي شَيْءٍ مِّن ذَلِكَ مِّن الْمَذْكُورَاتِ. They acknowledge all of that. And that Allah has no partner in all of what was mentioned. فَقُلْ. So you say to them, O Muhammad, after they acknowledge all of this, and it's clear that they acknowledge all of these matters, you say to them, إِلْزَامٍ بِالْحُجَّةِ. To compel them with what they already acknowledge. أَفَلَا تَتَّقُونَ. Will you then not fear Allah? If you acknowledge all of this, will you then not fear Allah? Meaning what? تُخْلِصُونَ لَهُ الْعِبَادَ وَحْدَهُ. Make all your worship sincerely for Him alone, without any partners. وَتَخْلَعُونَ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ مِن دُونِهِ مِنَ الْأَنْدَادِ وَالْأَوْثَانِ. And leave off everything that you worship besides Him. And that you leave everything off that you worship besides Allah, the one who that you already affirm that does all those actions that precede it. Now, so again, this verse shows you that the disbelievers, they affirm Allah's actions as rububiyyah. And they knew that He had no partner in those matters. But even with this, they turn acts of worship, such as seeking blessings and supplication and praying, other than that, to other than Allah. They directed them towards saints and righteous men and pious men, and pious people, even women, or stones or trees or other false deities, believing they could bring benefit to them or intercede for them with Allah. So these were some of the false beliefs that Allah sent His messengers to eliminate. These were some of the false beliefs that Allah sent His messengers to eliminate. Because all of that constitutes setting up rivals and equals and partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so just like this, just like we just mentioned, if you ask the majority of the disbelievers, anybody you encounter just walking down the street, who created them? Or who sends down the rain? Or who gives life and decrees death? Then their response will be who? God. They will say God. But at the same time, they direct acts of worship and devotion to other than God alone. They directed to the creation, such as the prophets, or the pious, or the righteous, or the pious. Those who they themselves are created. Those who they themselves are provided for. And they sleep, and they drink, and they use the bathroom. So a principle is, Ikhwani wa akhawati, my dear brothers and sisters, anyone or anything that is needy, eats, drinks, sleeps, cries, happy at some times, sad at other times, then they are not suitable to be a deity worthy of all worship and devotion. It is not possible that they be suitable to be the deity worthy of all worship and devotion. But rather the deity worthy of all worship and devotion is Allah alone, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one who does those actions that we just mentioned in the ayah. The one not in need of food. The one not in need of drink. The one not in need of sleep. One not in need of using the bathroom. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-ghani al-hamid. The self-sufficient worthy of all praise. So the point is here, is one does not enter into Islam by merely affirming Allah's rububiyyah, his lordship. But along with that, along with affirming Allah's actions, his lordship, they must single out Allah with all acts of worship, because he is the only one deserving of such devotion and sincerity. Why is this? Go back to rububiyyah, because he is the sole creator. He's the one who gave you life. He's the one that gave you, he's the one that decreed death. And he's the one that will raise you back up again. He's the one who controls the heavens and the earth and everything in between it. He's the one who provides for you the water that you drink, the food that you eat. So if it's only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that can do these matters and no one from the creation can do them, this shows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's the only one deserving of all worship. And we find this in the Quran in many places. And this is what we're getting to here. That Tawhid al-Rububiyyah, Allah has made it an argument, because the disbelievers, they already affirm it, to compel them to confirm, to affirm this next type of Tawhid, which is Tawhid al-uluhiyyah. Naam. So, with that, we'll get to the second type. The second type of tawheed is tawheed al-uluhiyyah. Tawheed al-uluhiyyah. Some say tawheed al-ibadah. Whether you say this or that, la bas, it's no problem. Tawheed al-uluhiyyah or tawheed al-ibadah. The tawheed a worship. And this is to have belief that Allah is the only one worshipped in truth, and that he has no partners in that. And that's why we say, when we say the meaning of La ilaha Allah, we're going to get to that inshallah in a few chapters. La ma'abuda bihaqin illallah. There's no deity worthy of worship in truth except Allah. Because many deities are worshipped. People worship saints. People worship pious men, people worship trees, stones, people worship numerous things. None of those things have the right to be worshipped. All of those things are deficient, created, or are either in need themselves. So no one has the right to be worshipped in truth except Allah. So this is Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, belief that Allah is the only one worshipped in truth, and that he has no partners in that. Or one can say, it is that the servants single out Allah with their actions. Meaning we single out Allah with our actions. Such as dua. When we supplicate, we only supplicate to Allah alone. Not to anyone from mankind. Or the creation. Or that which is created. Or nadhr, when making a vow. Or when slaughtering. Or as it relates to fear. Was it relates to placing our trust and reliance, tawakkul, and every other type of worship that Allah commanded with, it must be directed to Allah
alone. So all acts of worship must be directed to Allah alone. And this is the type of tawhid that the messengers came with. And the reason why Allah sent down the books of revelation. So look, understand this. The messengers, they didn't come to teach the people tawhid al-rububiyyah. Why? Because it's something innate within the people already. It's something innate within the people. It's something people have within them from their natural disposition. Tawhid al-rububiyyah. So, the messenger, they were sent. And the reason the messengers were sent, and the reason why the books were revealed, is to bring the people back to the worship of Allah alone. The reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the creation. Now, so this is the type of tawheed that the messengers came with, and the reason why Allah sent down the books of revelation, so that all worship be directed sincerely and solely to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's look at some of the evidences for this. Allah said, وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُ بِهِ وَلَا تُشْرِكُ بِهِ شَيْئًا. Affirmation and negation in this ayah. The same meaning of La ilaha illallah. That which you say when you pronounce the shahada. Worship Allah. Worship Allah. وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ. It's an affirmation. وَلَا تُشْرِكُ بِهِ شَيْئًا. Enjoy none and partners along with him. Meaning nothing. This is شَيْئًا, indefinite. In the context of being in the context of negation, shay'an is, in, as far as the Arabic language, this is indefinite. In the Arabic, as it relates to the Arabic language, and it's in the context of negation. So this shows generality, meaning enjoying nothing in partners along with Allah, no matter what it may be. Worship Allah, enjoying none in partners along with Him. And likewise, Allah said, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِن قَبْلِكَ مِن رَّسُولٍ إِلَّا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَعْبُدُونَ. And we sent not before you any messenger, except that we revealed to him that there is no deity in truth except me, so worship me. Now, so this is the call of all the prophets and messengers. Look at the next ayah. وَلَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَّسُولًا أَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَجَتَنِبُ الطَّاغُوتِ. And we certainly sent to every nation a messenger, saying, worship Allah and avoid the false deities, the طاغوت. And we certainly sent to every nation a messenger, saying, worship Allah and avoid the false deities. So this type of tawheed, this second type, tawheed al-uluhiyyah, is where the disputes between the messengers and their nations occurred. It wasn't regarding Tawhid al-Rububiyyah. As the majority of mankind, they already recognized this, that the Creator is one and his actions. However, many failed to single him out with all acts of worship. And for this reason, the scholars, they give so much importance to Tawhid before anything else. In their writings or in their lectures, and their admonitions, etc. Why? Because number one, this is why Allah created the creation. And we learned this in the introduction. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. So Allah mentions, and I have not created jinn or mankind except to worship me. Meaning what? That Allah be singled out in worship. This is what is meant. That Allah be singled out in worship, which is tawheed. So this is why Allah created the creation. Likewise, as we just seen in these ayat, it was the first call of all the prophets and messengers to their people. It was a call to correct the belief system, the aqidah, what we spoke about last week, that foundation that every Muslim must have in order to benefit from their Islam and benefit from their actions and to grow in their Islam. They must have that firm foundation, the aqidah. So this is what the prophets and messengers came with, to correct the belief system, the aqidah, and to call to tawheed, to singling Allah out with all worship. and to purify it from all those false beliefs that have crept into it. From giving equals and partners to Allah, from superstitions, and everything else that taints the purity of Tawhid. So dear brothers and sisters, Tawhid and learning it is the very, very first thing that will rectify individuals, that will rectify societies, that will rectify countries. Because if one knows who their Lord is, and if one knows what Allah has tasked us with, what He's placed upon us, from the matters of worship and obedience, and if one knows the tremendous reward for those who worship Allah alone, and the honor He gives them in this life, and the reward of an everlasting bliss in paradise that He's prepared for them in the hereafter, meaning the believers, those who worship Allah alone. If a person knows this and believes this, then there's nothing that a person won't leave off for the sake of pleasing their Lord. One will leave off oppression, oppressing people. One will leave off deceit. One will leave off treachery. One will leave off killing, racism. One will leave racism off because they know that this is something that Allah doesn't like. These matters that we just mentioned. All these ills, a person will leave off seeking the reward of their Lord and His pleasure. So therefore, Tawheed is the most important thing. And this is the greatest thing that will rectify people. We don't need to start with social movements and the likes of those matters to bring justice and to bring equality and things like this. Tawheed is the origin of what will bring all of that. Tawheed is the origin and the foundation that will bring about all of that. So therefore, Tawheed is the most important thing. It rectifies individuals, groups, societies, for those who call to it, for those who make it the basis of their call, and for those who implement it. And because of this, you won't find among the Muslims anyone giving importance to the call of Tawheed before anything else except Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah. Those who follow the Salaf of this Ummah, the Salafis, they are the foremost of reviving the call to Tawheed, teaching it, spreading it, calling to it, and warning from its opposite. So continuing, in Ibn Kathir, he says, and this just emphasizes what we stated earlier, he says, all the types of worship which Allah commanded, like Islam, Iman, Ihsan, and from that is Dua, invocation, and fear, Khawf, Ar-Raja, hope and longing, trust and reliance, Tawakkul, fervent desire, Raghba, dread, Rahba, reverence and humility, Khushu', awe, Khashya, Al-Inaba, turning repentantly to Allah, appealing for aid and assistance, Isti'ana, seeking refuge, Isti'adha, seeking deliverance and rescue, Istighatha, sacrificing, dhabh, vows, nadhr, and the rest of the types of worship commanded by Allah, all of them are to be done exclusively for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of them are to be done. So this is approved. This speech of Ibn Kathir, one of the great imams of the 8th century in Islam, he has a famous tafsir al-Quran al-Azim, more famously known as Tafsir Ibn Kathir, explanation of the verses of the Book of Allah, the Quran. He's mentioning in these in his words that he's mentioning some examples showing that all acts of worship, they must be directed only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And they must be done exclusively for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Okay, getting into the third type of tawheed, so we can end on this inshallah ta'ala. Tawheed al-asma wa-sifat. Tawheed al-asma wa-sifat, which is the tawheed of Allah's names and attributes. The tawheed of Allah's names and attributes. This is to have belief in all the names and attributes of Allah This is to have belief in all the names and attributes of Allah that have been reported in the Quran or authentic ahadith. So as a Muslim, we only affirm those names and attributes of Allah that he had affirmed for himself in the Quran, or what his messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam affirmed for him in his authentic sunnah, without distorting them, without denying them, without asking how, and without making a resemblance of Allah to his creation. And a person does not give Allah a name and description or attribute that he has not named or described himself with. How many times do you hear the kuffar in their songs? And other than that, they may describe Allah with things, and they describe God with things that they don't, that they, it came from their own selves. Something they made up, or something they believe that God should be described with, and they have no proof for that. In Islam, we don't do that. We only name Allah, and we only say about Allah what he said about himself. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is most knowledgeable of himself. And likewise his prophets, his messengers. So we say about Allah what he said about himself. And we describe him with what he described himself with. And we give him attributes that he named himself with, or that which has come in the sunnah of his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nor does one deny or reject what Allah has named himself or described himself with. So we find an attribute established in the Qur'an, or a name established in the Qur'an, or the authentic sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we affirm it. And at the same time, we maintain the belief that there is nothing similar to him, the Most High, free of imperfections. And from the proofs for this is Allah says in the Qur'an, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٌ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٌ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ There is nothing like unto him. Showing there's nothing similar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's nothing like unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But even with this, he said, وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ And he is the all-hearer, all-seer. طيب, us as human beings, do we have hearing? Yes. Do we have seeing? Yes. Likewise, Allah mentioned regarding himself, وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ He affirmed for himself, hearing and seeing. But look at the beginning of that verse. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ There's nothing like unto him. So it shows as well. And this is, we can say this about all the names and attributes of Allah. That Allah has hearing, not like the hearing of the creation. Allah has seeing, not like the seeing of the creation. And you can say this about every attribute that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned regarding himself. So we don't say that Allah's hearing is like our hearing. We don't say that Allah's seeing is like our seeing. Because Allah said, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ There's nothing like unto him. And then right after that, he affirmed for himself the attribute of hearing and seeing. Now, so Allah has hearing, not like the hearing of the creation. He has seeing, not like the seeing of the creation. We say this regarding all the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And likewise, Allah says, وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى فَدُعُوهُ بِهَا وَذَرُوا الَّذِينَ يُلْحِدُونَ فِي أَسْمَائِهِ سَيُجْزَوْنَ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ And to Allah belongs the best names. So invoke him by them. And leave the company of those who practice deviation concerning his names. They will be recompensed for that which they have been doing. Now, so Allah affirms in this verse that to him belongs the best names. So we call upon Allah with those names. Now, Ya Ghafur, اغفر لنا. O one who forgives, forgive us. Ya Rahim, irhamna. O the most merciful, have mercy upon us. Ya Razzaq, urzuqna. O all provider, provide for us. And like this, we call upon Allah with his names. We invoke Allah by his names. And likewise, we stay away from those who deviate regarding the names of Allah. Those who deny them and those who reject the names of the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We leave their company. We don't sit around them. We don't befriend them. Because you have these individuals that ascribe to Islam. They ascribe to Islam, but they've deviated as it relates to this type of tawhid. They deny or they reject the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or they resemble Allah to his creation. Other than that, And this is from the types of deviation regarding the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah commands us to leave off those who go astray regarding His name. So we know anybody like that, then we don't sit around them. Nah. And likewise Allah said, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. This is a tremendous surah, Surah Al-Ikhlas. And I want all the new Muslims to memorize this surah. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. A surah is that our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned that it equals a third of the Quran. Because the whole of this surah contains Tawhid. It contains Tawhid. Tawhid al-Rububiyyah wal-Uluhiyyah wal-Asma' wal-Sifat. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. Say He is Allah, the One, the self-sufficient Master, whom all creatures are in need. Allah is not in need of anyone. He has no offspring, nor was He born, and there is none co-equal or comparable unto Him. And some of the examples of the names of Allah, Ar-Rahman, the most merciful. Ar-Rahman, Allah's mercy comprises all of His creation, the believer and the disbeliever. We all benefit from the oxygen that we breathe, that Allah placed on this earth. We all benefit from its water, its air. Other than that, having eyes, having hearing, having sight, Ar-Rahim, the bestower of mercy. And this is mercy particular to the believers. Ar-Rahim, the mercy of Allah, which is particular to the believers, to the Muslims. Also from His names, As-Sami', the All-Hearer, Al-Basir, the All-Seer. And the verse that we've just read not too long ago, Al-Alim, the All-Knowing. Nothing escapes the knowledge of Allah, not in the heavens nor in the earth. Al-Ghafur, the All-Forgiving, the one who forgives sins. And some examples of Allah's attributes, Al-Hayat, that Allah has perfect life, not preceded by death or non-existence, and Allah will never die. Al-Hayat. Allahu la ilaha illa hu al-hayyu al-qayyum. And the greatest ayat in the Quran, Ayatul Kursi. Surah Al-Baqarah, the second surah, Ayat 255. Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum, the all-living, having perfect life. Al-ulu, from His attributes likewise as well as al-ulu, highness above His creation, that Allah is above His creation. So we don't say that Allah is everywhere, as you find some people they say. We say, but rather Allah is above His creation, as He described Himself in many ayat in His book. Likewise, al-wajh, from His attributes, that He has a face, not like the face of the creation. Again, go back to that verse in Surah Ash-Shura, the 42nd Surah, Ayat 11. There's nothing like Him. Okay, Al-Yad, that Allah has a hand, but not like the hand of His creation. There's nothing like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But He affirmed that He has a hand, so we say that He has a hand. Al-Nuzul, that Allah descends in a manner befitting His majesty, such as the hadith that some may be familiar with, some may not be familiar with. That Allah descends in the last third of the night. He says, who is supplicating for me that I may answer them? Who is calling upon me? So I can respond to them until the end of the hadith. Al-Kalam, that Allah speaks how He wishes and whenever He wishes. That Allah speaks how He wishes and whatever whenever He wishes. And from His speech is the Quran. And from His speech is the Torah. And from His speech is the Injil, His revealed books. Al-Istiwa, likewise from His attributes, Al-Istiwa, that Allah rose above His throne in a manner befitting His majesty. So we don't ask how Allah rose. If Allah says He rose, we say Allah rose, and we say it's in a manner befitting His majesty. وَلَيْسِ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There's nothing like Him. And with this, inshallah, ta'ala, we'll end this lesson. هَذَا وَصَلَى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمْ وَبَارَكَ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَ مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وصحبه وسلم. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.